always still going to be back there, and you're always welcome to keep going back and grabbing more. So, in fact, we encourage you to, as you see, there's quite a bit of food back there. And I think the best place to start is to recognize Ronnie, Kelly, and Lee, who have put together this evening and the food and the spread. Thanks to them for making it yet another successful evening. Welcome to our December colloquium. We're very pleased to have our colleague Karen Ross presenting tonight. But before that, I'd like to just make a few announcements. First and foremost, remember the sign-in sheet so they get credit for coming here tonight. Is right there back where Ronnie is standing up, holding up the sheet. If you haven't signed in, you won't get credit. So please do sign in before you leave. It'll be there all throughout, so make sure you don't leave without signing in. Second is that the registration deadline for classes is December 31st. That's coming up pretty quick for next time around. So you know, make sure you're talking to Ronnie and to us, the faculty, if you have any questions about the classes. Talking to faculty about the substance of the classes. If you have concerns and you're thinking about which ones you want to take, let us know. In addition, we've got a really jam-packed week next week of events that I hope you will try to make time to join. First is Professor Margaret Keck is coming on Tuesday night to talk about drought and denial in Sao Paulo in Brazil. I think a really, really fascinating talk. That's at 5:30 as well. No? It's 6:30. 4:30. Right here in the campus center. Right?
Quinn.
You see this? All the information is back there for the speakers. Yeah, sorry, I wrote down everything except for time and place. So, anyway, 4:30 in the Quinn building on Tuesday, Margaret Keck, Brazil, drought and denial. I think a fascinating talk. Professor Keck is really an outstanding scholar in the field, and you'd be missing out if you didn't show up. So try to make time. I know this time is a really busy time of year with finals and final papers and all that kind of stuff, but it's really worthwhile. And we've got two opportunities to hear a dynamic duo of speakers from Nigeria. They're known globally as the Imam and the Pastor, or the Pastor and the Imam. They are two former radical Christian leaders in Nigeria. Nigeria is a country that's divided 50-50 Muslim-Christian. They tried to kill each other on multiple occasions, later reconciled, and formed a peace organization. So they're going to be here on Wednesday at 4 o'clock for an informal chat to talk, to facilitate a conversation for us about Islam in times of crisis. And this is particularly in response to the bombings in Paris. Putting Islam in the forefront and the tension between the very tiny group of sort of radical Islam between the vast majority of moderate Islam worldwide. They're going to talk about, first of all, the Imam's going to talk about, obviously as a Muslim religious figure, what it's like to be a Muslim, to try to explain these differences and the tensions there. But then Pastor James is a Christian who talks to Christian communities constantly in Nigeria who have issues with Muslims, to say, what do you say to non-Muslims about Islam? And how do you try to manage these issues? So it's really meant to be a conversation about this new uptick in violence, especially as we look at the Islamic State in the Middle East, and we see the Paris bombings, and bombings in Lebanon and other places, then Boko Haram in Nigeria. They're going to talk about those things. And then on Thursday, they're going to be over at Harvard at the Divinity School at 6 o'clock. But you all are welcome. But you have to RSVP on the link on their website. And it's on our website if you want to go. They're going to talk about their peace-building methods, how they do peace-building, how they do interreligious peace-building. So Wednesday, they're going to be talking more about current events and thinking about engaging Islam, particularly as peacemakers, what do we do? Then on Thursday, they're going to talk about their own work in interreligious peace building across the Muslim-Christian divide in Nigeria. So it's my great pleasure to introduce our colleague, Karen Ross. Karen got her PhD from Indiana University just a few years ago. She's the rookie in the department, but she has quickly established herself among the rest of us and is surpassing a number of us. As well. She does peace education She does dialogue work and research and methods and evaluation as well. And tonight she's going to talk about her work in Israel between Israelis and Palestinians, which I'm very excited to hear more about. Please join me in welcoming Karen Ross.
Workshop, a weekend, part of a weekend workshop implemented by an organization called Sadaka. I work with them. Peace Child Israel and Tzedakah Re'ut, two organizations that were founded in the 1980s to implement encounters between Jewish and Palestinian youth. You can see in this chart that there's some kind of main points of comparison between the two similarities. They're both founded in the 1980s, so they've been around for a long time. Peace Child closed in 2011, and I will get back to the importance of that later on, but implemented its programs continuously for its almost 23 years of program implementation, and Tzedakah Re'ut has been operating continuously since the early 1980s, so now going into its fourth decade of programmatic work. They work, or worked in the case of Peace Child, with young people from about the same age groups, and importantly, they engaged in encounters, or engage in encounters, that occur over a relatively long period of time. So we're not talking here about a single weekend workshop or one-off seminar. We're talking about programs that bring young people together on a weekly basis over an entire academic year, two academic years, in some cases three academic years. So really, in that way, build a foundation for ongoing relationship building and individual transformation. Those are some of the points of similarity. The two organizations differed, I guess, very much in their overall approach that they use in their work. So Peace Child, kind of similar to these organizations I was talking about, like Soccer for Peace and Ultimate Peace and so forth, use theater as an approach for bringing together young Jewish and Palestinian teenagers, met for role-playing exercises, acting workshops, getting to know one another, cultural, social activities. Over the first half of the year and the second half of the year, would rehearse and perform a bilingual Hebrew-Arabic play, but really focused on this more interpersonal approach. And the organization saw these opportunities for dialogue, these opportunities for encounters as an end goal. And what I mean by that is that they really were trying to counter the segregation in the Israeli context, where Jewish and Palestinian young people hardly meet in any kind of, certainly not in any kind of positive setting, and offer them an opportunity to get to know one another in a structured environment that would lead to positive relationships. And as I think the director of the organization at one point told me, you know, we really want them to come out of this not hating each other. So you can think, you know, I mean, think of what the starting point is. If their objective is for these people, these young people, these participants, not to hate each other as a goal. Tzedakah Re'ut is a very, very different kind of organization. Its main mission, it kind of sees its mission as educating its participants for critical awareness of systemic issues in Israeli society, of social imbalances, power imbalances related to the Jewish-Palestinian conflict, but also dynamics between other groups within the Israeli context, and uses this idea of encounters of Jewish-Palestinian partnership not necessarily as just a way to bring people together in an end goal, but really as a model, as a means for modeling social change in Israel, and thinking about partnership as an approach for moving towards change in the Israeli context. So it's got a very, very different set of objectives, different approach to working, and as I will, I'll get to this a little bit later on, if these have some important implications for thinking about their potential. So, as I mentioned, I started my work with these organizations as part of my dissertation, and at that point, I was interested in kind of a nested set of questions about impact. The first was, how do alumni of these two programs, Peace Child and Tzedakah Re'ut, understand or perceive of the impact of participation in these programs on their lives? But I was interested in looking at this not just in a kind of isolated way, but thinking about it within the framework of the organization and the approaches that they use and the work that they do. So thinking about how the programs matter, or do they matter, in terms of the impact that individual participants perceive. And second, thinking about this within the overall framework of the Israeli context, the socio-political context. So these encounters aren't taking place in a vacuum. There are organizations that are functioning within a volatile conflict environment. The conflict itself, violence, more or less, you know, kind of prevalent in everyday life, at different points in time, and certainly the overall mood in periods like the 1990s after the signing of the Oslo Accords, very different than in the early 2000s after the outbreak of the Al-Aqsa Intifada. So thinking about that also in terms of how it shapes the impact. And at this point, I was interested germ of data collection was life history interviews that I conducted with 73 former participants in peace, child, and Sadaka, ranging from participants who had been in the organizations in the early years, the 1980s, through just a couple of years prior to when I was conducting my fieldwork. This meant that I had kind of a range of ages and people with different lengths of time they'd been away from the organization I was looking at. And I tried to kind of equalize the number of participants from each of the programs, males and females, Jews and Palestinians, and then different periods of times in which they participated. Now, from a methodological standpoint, you could talk about the benefits and challenges and maybe disadvantages of using this approach. But when we think about impact, there's a very important reason that I made the decision to use life history interviews. And when I mentioned earlier that one of the interrelated questions I was interested in is who defines impact. Now, there's been a tremendous amount of research on encounters in the Israeli context, Israeli-Palestinian context, and other conflict areas, Northern Ireland, the Balkans, Cyprus, etc. And most of this research uses an approach that is focused on giving participants a questionnaire, maybe prior to their participation in the encounter, and then right after the encounter, maybe 3 or 6 months after the encounter, maybe up to a year afterwards. So looking at change over time, over a relatively short period of time, first of all. But also, when you design questionnaires and give participants questionnaires in order to understand the impact of their participation, it means that you as the researcher, maybe in conjunction with staff from the organization, but almost certainly without any input from participants in these programs, are making the decision a priori about what kind of impact you're interested in looking at or looking for, right? So you talk about things like attitudes towards the other side. You can talk about things like the way individuals define peace, the willingness to become friends with individuals from the other side. These are all things that the studies have looked at, but it's not the participants themselves who are deciding what the impact of participating in these programs are. It's others who are making that decision for them. And my choice to use life history interviews, in addition to the kind of temporal dimension, right, so that you can understand these programs as contextualized within a broader life history, was also because as an approach, it allows participants in these programs, or former participants, I should say, to talk about the elements of their experience that were most significant to them. Talk about what the impact was in their view, the things that matter to them in terms of participating in these programs and how it shaped them as individuals. So I think when we talk about impact, again, when we talk about who decides what impact is and how we're measuring impact, that this is something that makes a difference, right? And again, I said you could talk about the benefits and disadvantages of this approach, but it's an important element to thinking about impact. So to go back to the substantive question about whether encounters have an impact and actually what the research showed, there's kind of three main themes that emerged or issues that emerged as ways that participants in my research talked about the impact of participating in this child and sadaka. The first has to do with the way they discussed adherence to dominant narratives in Israeli society, Jewish and Palestinian societies in Israel. So for those of us who talk about conflict and study conflict, of course we've heard of this idea of narratives, right? So historical narratives of different groups in conflict, narratives relating to things like victimhood and oppression and who's right and how you define these different events that took place over the course of the conflict. And these are narratives that young people are socialized into. Certainly within the Israeli school system, kids are socialized into kind of accepting and following and adhering to, adopting these narratives as part of their own narrative. And yet when I interviewed these former participants, they talked about their own personal narratives and the way they both implicitly and explicitly talked about dominant discourses in Jewish and Palestinian society. They really talked about shifts that had occurred within their own thinking about these narratives. So for example, willingness to critique their own narrative was something that came out in my among my participants as something that had been shaped by their participation in child and sadaka. They also talked about beliefs related, or they talked probably even more than at the time I was doing my interviews, people are really pessimistic about opportunities for change. But they also talked about their visions and theories of change, and by that I mean how they potentially envision society, Israeli society, could be, and how to get there, what is the mechanisms by which change will occur. And all three of these dimensions, they talked about the importance of peace, child, and tzedakah and shaping their lives. And the last thing they talked about, or they talked about actually a whole bunch of other things too, but these were kind of common to most of my participants, had to do with their continued activity in social change and peace building activities. So a large number of interviewees from both, well, from one organization and one together, talked about things they continue to do and how they were inspired or motivated to do so by their participation in Peace, Child, and Tzedakah. So continued participation in other kinds of encounter dialogue programs, participation in social movement activities or in advocacy groups. Some people even involved in government work to try to kind of change things from the inside. And they talked about all three of these as being elements of change that they experienced as a result of their participation, or they attributed to their participation in Peace, Child, and Tzedakah. So these are three dimensions of change that kind of came out from this research as sort of a way of thinking about the impact of these two organizations, the impact of encounters. And I would argue that they're important in thinking about the impact of encounters more broadly in a number of different ways, but two I want to talk about have to do first with the depth of change that individuals experience as a result of this program. So a lot of the research that's been done has focused on things I mentioned before, things like do these encounters shape the way individuals, for example, might define peace or social distance, so how willing they are to befriend or spend time with someone from the other side. And I'd suggest that these are, you know, these are important, but they're not really closely connected to individuals' core identity, in the sense that it's not a strongly part of kind of the way individuals see themselves. When they talk about how they define peace, it's not necessarily, you know, explicitly related to their own sense of identity. But when you talk about things related to maybe their deeper beliefs about social change, how they can be a part of social change, or their own identity related to dominant discourses in Israeli society, it's really a kind of change that is much more of a deep internal change than I would say most of the research has really looked at, not to say that it isn't there or hasn't been there in other encounters, but again, I mean, we're talking about methods of defining how we should measure impact and the kinds of things that people have been looking at that haven't been addressed in the same kind of depth. And the other element of this, of course, and this comes from the use of retrospective life history interviews, is the change over time, or the way that these changes are maintained over time. So there's been some research, recent research, on encounters in the Israeli-Palestinian context that suggests that, yes, individuals are transformed in their belief systems by encounters, but that these are very short-lived changes, and they are, over time, as people they don't return, they're already in their own societies, but after the encounter occurs, after people leave the kind of setting of the encounter, that these changes aren't maintained. And on the other hand, the research that I did, these interviews that I did, the participants' discussions suggested that really these are changes that have stayed with them over a long period of time, and now we're talking about people who talked about experiences from 20 or 25 years before as really shaping significant beliefs actions and a sense of identity that has stayed with them over a long period of time. Now, when you think about why this is, first, I mentioned that most of the research has been really focused on the short term. But when you talk about, you know, why does other research suggest that these changes aren't maintained, I would argue that there's two main reasons. First, the research has actually suggested that the reason why these changes are so kind of, the reason why they aren't maintained is that they're not central beliefs, in the sense that there are beliefs, for example, about the legitimacy of the other side's narratives, but they're not beliefs that are really central to by participating in these encounters, the change is less likely, I would suggest, to be reversed because there isn't this kind of nurturing effect. So these are a couple of ways in which I think this research suggests that there is both a deep and a long-lasting impact on individuals from participating in these encounters. But when we talk about encounters and impact, we think about this as expanding circles of impact, right? So we don't want to just have an impact on these individuals. These organizations at a broader level are aiming to transform or somehow contribute to the transformation of Israeli society. And how could they potentially do that? Well, I'm not the only person who's been thinking about this. Some of you might be familiar with a group called the Reflecting and Peace Practice group at the, I guess now they're called the CDA, Collaborative Learning Environment or something. It used to be, their name has changed over time. But they're a group that's been thinking about the impact of peace-building initiatives, grassroots peace-building initiatives. And about a decade ago, they came out with a report that they've continued to build on, where they were looking at the kind of work that is done by peace-building initiatives in conflict contexts and the kind of impact that those initiatives can have. And they suggested that most organizations or initiatives fall into one of four, or kind of categorize them along two dimensions. Initiatives that are focused on change at the individual or personal level, so you can put encounters into that category, or initiatives that are focused more directly on change at the socio-political level. So, advocacy groups or protest movements or other kind of directly challenging policy organizations or groups. And they also talked about initiatives as either focused on what they refer to as more people, so these are kind of your grassroots, everyday citizens, again, encounters falling into that category, or key people in the conflict or people who are key to the transformation of conflict, religious leaders or government officials and so forth and so on. And they suggested that for these programs, these initiatives to have an impact, programs that are targeting the individual or personal level somehow have to tie in to initiatives or groups or endeavors that are aiming to make change at the socio-political level. So how does this relate back to encounters? If you remember, one of the things I talked about, I said that my participants talked about as an element of change was that they are continuing to be involved in socio-political activity. And here, I think we can start to see a connection between the individual level change or impact at an individual level and a contribution or attempt to contribute to change at a socio-political level, in the sense that the endeavors, the initiatives that these individuals are engaged in are often endeavors that are aiming to create societal level change directly. So as I said, there's some young people who have been working in government in order to try to transform the neighborhood inside. Who've been involved in a whole number of kind of social justice movements within the Israeli context, not all related to the Jewish-Palestinian conflict. A number who work with, for example, advocacy groups for asylees and refugees within Israel, who work with other kinds of social justice issues, but who have been motivated by these encounters to engage directly in social change activity in this way. And so you could think about there starting to be a link between how we think about individual level impact and the potential of encounters to have an impact at the individual level and impact at the broader socio-political level. But I would say there's also other ways of talking about impact and these expanding circles of impact. So also from the Reflecting on Peace Project, Mary Anderson, whose name you might be familiar with, said that institutionalization as an indicator points to changes at the level of a larger society. Now what does this mean? One of the indicators of impact, or one of the ways of thinking about impact, not in an individual level, might be the way in which endeavors, initiatives, can become incorporated into institutions in a conflict society, or legitimized by institutions in a conflict society. And in the case of these encounters, it's difficult to think about them really being kind of incorporated into, say, educational institutions, because the to make inroads into legitimization, being legitimized by the mainstream educational institution of Israel. So here we talk not only about the impact on individuals, but also about the organizational context, and especially looking at the approach of each of the organizations and their own theories of change, the work, the models that they've used. So remember, Peace Child Israel focused much more on kind of using theater as a joint activity, and looking at dialogue or encounters as an opportunity for bringing young people together as an end goal. And Sadakala was much more focused ideologically on social change, on creating this kind of critical awareness among its participants. And these two approaches have had very different outcomes for the organizations in terms of kind of their inroads within the Israeli educational system. So Peace Child's approach has really allowed it while it was still in existence, to maintain credibility within the Israeli educational institution. It recruited its young people every year through schools. It had its young people were then performing the plays in schools that they belonged to, and that other places in the communities that they belonged to. And the director told me that there were some very strategic choices made about how they decided to approach this. And she told me that in order to get the plays booked in the Jewish schools in particular, because the whole issue of Arab Jew was taboo, and because principals in these schools were worried about how their students would react to it, it being plays around the Arab-Jewish-Palestinian conflict, they didn't want to touch it. So we decided that if we want to have any chance of having Jewish schools see the show, we need to bring shows that they can rely on not to be provocative. So they're avoiding being provocative of what they're doing in order to maintain kind of a presence in the schools, and in that way, potentially have an impact not only on the participants, but ideally, from the perspective of the organization, also somehow touch those young people, those students in the school who are seeing the plays. And so what they decided to do is bring in plays that were about social issues, conflict issues, but in other environments or other contexts. The group I observed when I was doing my field work was rehearsing and performing West Side Story. For those of you familiar with the play, obviously there's a lot of conflict there, but it takes place in New York. It doesn't take place in Israel-Palestine. And as a result, much more palatable to school principals, much more palatable to education, the institution of education, and administrators who make the decisions about whether to let the organization in. And so it made a strategic choice to focus on maintaining institutional legitimacy, whereas Sadaka Le'ut, due to its ideological focus, has had a much more difficult time with this. One of the former directors of Sadaka told me, in contrast with what the Peace Child director said, that I think it's become more difficult to enter formal institutions for Sadaka Le'ut. There's more suspicion. One of our coordinators was yelled at in a school because somebody there saw that we had an activity against the 2009 war in Gaza, so she was yelled at. And what he was referring to is the fact, or what he's alluding to here is the fact that Sadaka Le'ut as an organization is not trying to not be provocative. It actually is trying to be provocative. It's trying to get its participants to think about social issues, to participate in perhaps, in this case, young people who are participating in a protest against the war. And as a result, in the eyes of figures, educational figures, administrators, in the dominant institution, right, to the Jewish schools in particular, it's really problematic. And you can think about this in terms of when you talk about which approach has a greater impact, you can think about this in a number of ways. So first, if Peace Child is able to enter more schools, it means it can recruit more participants, it means it can perform in more schools, it means it can potentially touch a whole broad range of young people in Israel and have an impact on them as individuals in a much broader way. Sadaka Le'ut, one of the biggest complaints I heard about it, even from participants, former participants, and staff members who were really committed to the organization, was that it wasn't able to recruit, to get involved with, to somehow touch larger number of individuals. Because its approach is so confrontational, it makes it much more difficult to kind of toe the line and maintain some sort of legitimacy within dominant institutions. So when you talk about impact, you can ask, which one is having a greater impact, right? But I think there's a major trade-off here, because we talk about impact at an organizational level or institutional level in contrast with impact at an and remember these kind of elements of impact that individual participants talk to me about, these were really shaped in different ways. Participants from the two organizations talked about these in different ways. And I would say that differences in the organizational approach really shape these outcomes, not just the degree to which they focus on the conflict and on social inequality, but also on issues related to, for example, the organizational structure and the programmatic structure, the opportunities created for relationship building and informal settings within the two organizations, and also in the kind of skills and knowledge emphasized. So these differences between the two organizations at a structural and programmatic level shape the level or degree of impact at an individual level. And just to make one of these concrete, or make it a little bit more concrete, when we talk about the two organizations in terms of their organizational and programmatic structure, Peace Child is a very structured, I would say, hierarchical organization. I never saw anybody in the office other than the director and the office manager. The facilitation manual for the program was set up so that like each 10-minute block was, the facilitators knew what to do for every 10 minutes, very kind of coordinated across the different groups. And Sadaka Le'ut, on the other hand, continues to be very non-hierarchical in its overall structure, gives its facilitators a lot of leeway to focus on issues that each of them think their group needs to address. And also is kind of like a hangout place, right? So when I go to their offices, I always see participants there talking to staff members, chatting it up, forming these kind of relationships that are so important. And we know this from the social movement literature, that these social networks are so important for motivating continual activity related to social change, right? So it's not enough that people feel inspired to act. They also need to have networks of people around them who are encouraging them to act, who are motivating them to continue being involved in whatever endeavors they're involved in. And you see this in two ways. Concretely in the data for my research. One is in actually the number of individuals that participants in these organizations come in touch with. Now this is a really simplified analysis, but you can see there's a difference Peace Child on average, and remember now we're talking about participants from, let's say, 3 to 25 years out of their experiences in the organization. Keeping in touch on average for Peace Child with one other participant, so that could lead to with three. I mean, you can talk about how significant these numbers are in different ways, but I think these kind of starting to have support networks is really important also for them thinking about who is participating in social change activity and how many from each of the two organizations. You can see there's a really big distinction here between the number and percentage of former participants who continue to be involved, and for Peace Child. And I would attribute this certainly not only to kind of the structure of the organization and relationships, certainly also to the programmatic approach overall, but I think this is an important element to think about. And in either case, I mean, what it comes down to is thinking about, you know, if you're going to try to have an impact at an individual level, a deeper impact, then there's some trade-offs between that and the potential impact in terms of reaching out broader numbers, especially in this conflict context. And at the end, I mean, when you think about it, these encounter organizations are trying to shape individual participants within a conflict society, but they're also working to shape that society as a whole and being shaped by Israeli society in terms of what they consider provocative, what they consider as legitimate, or what they're able to do in order to reach out to other numbers of individuals, to greater numbers of or reach them in a way. So I want to just kind of focus one more time on thinking about this next element of my research, that we're talking about the potential impact on individuals. But in the end, we're also talking about the impact of the organizational context not only on individuals, but as it relates to the broader socio-political context in which it's being implemented, right? So the approach that's used by each of the organizations is shaping how much of an impact they can have on individuals, also how accepted they are within the context. And if you recall, Peace Child closed in 2011, and so I would say there's one other element here that's important to consider. It's not just the local context within Israel, but also the international context almost all the funding for these kinds of activities now, certainly for Peace Child and Sadaka La'ut, came from international NGOs, from funding agencies like USAID, so from kind of global community. And the perception of what's considered a legitimate approach or an acceptable approach by these international actors is not necessarily the same as what's considered legitimate by institutions within Israel proper. Certainly after 2000, after the outbreak of the Intifada, there was a significant shift in how a lot of these organizations, there was a huge decrease in the number of encounter organizations functioning because there was a shift within the community towards recognizing the need for Palestinian empowerment, towards recognizing the legitimacy of the Palestinian narrative, something that hadn't really been addressed in a lot of encounters. And the organizations that were able to survive, for the most part, were those that shifted their approach to be more in tune with this, even as the Israeli environment as a whole, and we could see tensions within Israel between Jews and Palestinians after 2000 continuing to rise up until this day, and certainly in the last couple of months that's reached a peak we haven't seen in a long time. But the international context really focusing much more on these issues of equality between groups and power dynamics and so forth. So when we talk about the potential of the organization is to be seen as legitimate in the Israeli context, that also comes as a bit of a trade-off with their potential to be seen as, you know, productive peace building or social change organizations in the international context. And certainly that is true when you think about the difference between Peace Child, which closed, and Sadaka La'ut, which on the other hand has continued to get actually a lot more funding and has opened several more programs since I first started my research with them as a result of, you know, opportunities from a number of different organizations. So coming back at the end to this question about do encounters have an impact? Well, I would say first of all, yes, they do. Certainly in an individual sense, my research shows that these encounters can have both a deep impact on individuals in terms of how kind of central they are to shifting the core of how they see themselves, and also in the duration of that impact. But I think at the end, when we talk about the potential of encounters to have an impact, can't just think about it at that individual level. We also need to consider what we mean by impact, at what level we're looking at impact, in the context in which we're talking about impact, both locally and globally. And I'm going to end there so that we have plenty of time for questions and research.
Those who are involved in this kind of activities are those who already have kind of optimistic or positive view about peace, while the ones that have to be altered are the ones who have kind of skeptical view about peace. I mean, when I was in a similar program in Wales in 2011, also about Israel and Palestine, I think the ones who were recruited are the ones who are kind of positive to peace, and even among them, like when we were interacting in the common room, there are still tensions. I think it's important to touch upon the
the organizations actually, in terms of to the organizations who participate, the organizations have changed over time. But certainly in the last decade, both Peace Child's last decade of programming and Sadaka La'ut in general has not necessarily been focused on recruiting young people who are already interested or kind of optimistic about things. I would say for both, the participants in the programs are to the organization. And certainly, I mean, I saw this in the groups that I observed, that a lot of them were not very kind of left-wing or peace-snick participants at all. Many of them came from families that were very right-wing, that were very against, like, you know, the signing a peace treaty or giving land to the Palestinians. So that kind of, their approach has been really different in the sense that they have turned away from working with the communities in Israel that have been most traditionally involved in the peace movement and focused much more on marginalized communities of, say, Ethiopian, former Ethiopian, or not former Ethiopian, immigrants from Ethiopia, or communities of Jews from the Mizrahi Jews who are from, whose families came from other parts of the Middle East. Have been much less involved in the peace building process, but also have been traditionally discriminated against relative to kind of their European Jewry. So there's, I think it's an important question to address. These two organizations, again, at least in the last kind of decade of the work they've done, have not focused on drawing from those that you would think most likely to be kind of yay, gung-ho, and people talked about this in their interviews as well.
by connecting the following. The more confrontational the approach, the more likely to affect core beliefs, the more likely to have a lasting impact. Because I heard those things, but I didn't know if you were comfortable about tying that sequence together.
I would say not with that kind of predictive statement, but there is a connection between the approach that Sadako uses and you know, in my research, what people talk about. Yes?
You could mention that the founding of the academy is usually from conventional organizations. My question is about the location of these organizations. Are they national organizations? Territory-wise, they are in Israel. They are not individual places. They are national, so they are founded by the government.
No, they're non-profit organizations. They're local non-profit organizations. In
local means Israel.
Meaning that they're located in the state of Israel.
But who are the leaders of the organization?
In the case of Peace Child, the director was a Jewish woman, the pedagogical director was a Palestinian citizen, the facilitator of Jewish and Palestinian. In the case of Sadaka Lagut, it is co-directed by a Jew and a Palestinian. All of the program coordinators are co-Jewish and Palestinian. All facilitators are Jewish and Palestinian. It is very much, and I would say more than Peace Child, an organization that strives for equality organizationally as well as programmatically between Jewish and Palestinian citizens. And neither of them are government, they're non-governmental organizations.
If you'd hazard a guess, I mean, what percentage of Israeli and Palestinian teenagers go through any sort of program like this? And then if you would guess among those, how many, you know, what would be your guess in terms of the deeper sort of Sadaka style of encounter?
I heard a researcher say once that it's like 10%. So I don't know if that's actually the case. I'm not sure exactly where that number comes from. It's actually something that I've been trying to figure out how to really calculate that. But it's not a very high percentage. And I would say that the percentage of those who have some sort of similar experience is very low because there are not a huge number of organizations that are kind of these long-lasting, implement activities over multiple years. Programs, a lot of the encounters that people have are encounters that take place through their schools. So there's a number of organizations, including Nevishamam Mohabasamam, that will organize these like encounters for kids at a Jewish school and a Palestinian school in Israel, maybe like a long weekend, and some other activities over the course of several weeks, but not with this kind of duration. There's starting to be more now, so things like Ultimate Peace, their programs are, the center is the summer camp that they run, but they have activities all throughout the year for participants, and a lot of other organizations are moving more into that direction, but it's been a learning process also for organizations engaged in this work, understanding that this kind of follow-up, even organizations like Seeds of Peace, which started out just as this like isolated community camp experience, open centers in the region, not just in Israel, Palestine, but in all the regions where they work, for follow-up activities. But the number of participants is relatively low.
That percent is a highly significant number, actually. I mean, I know we're just guessing, but if it is that many, I mean, 1 in 10 Israelis and Palestinians have gone through something like this. That's I couldn't think of another country on the planet that would have that similar density of this kind of programming, which is fascinating. My follow-up is the institutionalization question. Have you seen, the Israeli government, the education ministry, or the Palestinian Authority side, has there ever been any movements to try to incorporate this into the formal education curriculum?
There was. So in Israel, the distinction between, I made a distinction at the beginning between encounters in Israel and encounters across, kind of cross-border encounters between Israelis and Palestinians, because the dynamics are very different, and the issues with established within the Ministry of Education. I forget what it was called. It was something like the Group for Jewish Arab Coexistence, or the Center for Jewish Arab Coexistence. And it was an organization or center within the Ministry of Education that was working to kind of address these racism against, mostly racism against Palestinians through educational programs. So there was, it existed for several years, and then in the wake of the Oslo Accords, the focus kind of shifted away from within Israel issues to looking at cross-border issues. And then in the wake of the last Intifada, it kind of all fell apart. And the ministry support for these kinds of endeavors has really depended on the political leadership, right? So the current minister, or not the current minister of education, the previous minister of education had tried to oust the director of the civic education center in Israel because he authorized as a legitimate textbook for use, a textbook for history in Israel that used the term Nakba, which is the Arabic word used for the events in 1948 around the founding of Israeli state, and it means catastrophe. So for the Palestinians, it was really a catastrophe. It's very strongly part of the narrative, but is really, you know, depending on political leadership in Israel, certainly now, you're not allowed to use that word in teaching about the history in the classroom. So there was this attempt to oust the leadership of the civic education center because he authorized a textbook that had the word in it. Right? So there's kind of now something of an opposite, there's a lot of challenge to anything reeking of pro-peace or kind of legitimizing Palestinian history. But it has existed in the previous periods.
We have time for one more question?
Yes. Yeah.
What are the chances that these kids in the university participated in these encounters would impact other kids to make maybe other organizations? Since there's like, you said there's like 10% of kids that have participated in these encounters. And what is the process like to open an organization or something like that? Is there like too much issues as far as like to open an organization like that? Because it sounds like something very beneficial for kids to have.
So in answer to your first question, I was back in Israel this summer and I did a series of interviews with some of them with individuals who I interviewed prior. So I was interested in kind of getting a sense of how the events in the last several years have potentially shifted any kind of the perceptions of their own beliefs or the context as a whole. And then the question about them influencing others, there have been a number of graduates from both of these programs that have been involved in either opening or being employed by or facilitating in the encounters and programs implemented by other organizations in Israel, and also individuals who, spent time in the United States and Europe who've been involved in those kinds of organizations elsewhere as well. The exact process for opening and registering as a nonprofit, this kind of organization, I can't really speak to. I've done a lot of, I kind of continue to work with Sadaka, but not at that level of.
Thank you, Karen. When you sign in before you leave, so you get credit. And you take food.
You know what?
My negotiation class will convene at 7 in the class.
Really? Should we talk maybe in the morning at some point? Just take 10 minutes and plan.